الله الرحمن الرحيم أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد في الأولين وصل على سيدنا محمد في الآخرين وصل على سيدنا محمد في النبيين وصل على سيدنا محمد في المرسلين وصل على سيدنا محمد في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين. We continue our blessed journey looking at the existence of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi. And we haven't even touched upon his life on earth, and we're seeing this magnanimous giving of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his generosity in the gift of giving us our Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi, who is this great, the most perfected Khalifa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth, the one that Sayyidina Adam turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through and sought forgiveness, the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gathered all of the prophets and took an oath from them that if he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes, they will believe in him and follow him. The one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent as a mercy to all of existence sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi. And we're going to continue looking at his existence sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi by looking today at a special station that he had. Al-Maqam Al-Ubudiyya, the station of servitude, the station of being a abd, a servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the station of taking what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you and not complaining if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala seems to withhold from you, the station of being happy with your Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, the station of just wanting your Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, the station of being completely humble before your Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala with nothing to show and no claim to offer. Our Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi, Allah had given him everything to show, and he had given him sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi every claim to put forth, and it would have been true, but he alayhi salatu wasalam, with all of that greatness, with all of that bestowal from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with being his most beloved creation, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi, he always maintained a spiritual maqam, a spiritual station of ubudiyya to Allah, complete servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala glorified our Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi by giving him the best of titles. You know, in this world, we want titles. We want titles in our jobs. We want titles when we walk into our mosques. We want title, I'm Sheikh so-and-so, I'm Imam so-and-so, I'm Ustad so-and-so, I'm Doctor so-and-so, I'm Engineer so-and-so. Those are all titles of this dunya. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave our Prophet the greatest of titles when he called him his abd. And we see that all throughout Al-Quran Al-Kareem, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, Alhamdulillah alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitab. Glory to the one, praise be to the one, praise be to the one who revealed upon his abd. Can you imagine that? The creator of the heavens and earth, the sustainer of everything we know and that which we don't know. He gives the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam the most sought after title in all of creation, being Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's servant. And he does so so many times throughout Al-Quran Al-Kareem, telling us how important of a station it is. And one time, Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam, he was sitting in the company of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi, and how lucky Sayyidina Jibreel was to be in his company, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi, and what company that must have been. He was his confidant, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi. And one day, as they're sitting together, as Imam Ahmad narrates, an angel starts to come from the sky. And our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi looks to that angel. And Sayyidina Jibreel, he tells our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that this angel that's coming towards you has never come to the earth, has never left his position from the day that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created him. How long that might have been, thousands of years, millions of years, we don't know. And so the angel comes to the presence of our Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alihi, and it greets our Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alayhi, and he tells him, Allah sent me to you to give you a choice. Do you want to be a king and a prophet, or do you want to be a abd, a servant and a prophet? Now the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alayhi, he looks to his confidant, he looks to his wazir, he looks to his close companion, Sayyidina Jibreel. And Sayyidina Jibreel says to him, O Muhammad, show humility. And so the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alayhi responds by choosing to be a servant and a prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alayhi. Even though he was given the choice, he always chose the path of humility sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alayhi. Sayyida Aisha, our beloved mother, his wife sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alayhi, she sees the Prophet praying all night long to the extent that his blessed feet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alayhi would swell in pain. And she would say to him, would seem to be a very practical question, O Messenger of God, why do you stand in prayer so long when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven all of your future and past sins? And the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alayhi, he says, I would like to be a thankful servant. I would like to be a thankful servant. Maintaining his humility in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all circumstances. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took care of our Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alayhi in ways that only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could do so. And so our Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alayhi, in this maqam of ubudiyya, this maqam of servitude, was always under divine care. We were looking and were informed about the maqam of ubudiyya, the station of servitude. How did he get there? He got there through the nourishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He got there through the oversight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah tells us in the Qur'an al-Kareem that didn't he, O Muhammad, find you as an orphan and gave you shelter? This verse is in Surah Al-Duha. Now, if we look at the life of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi, we see that he lost his father and his mother at a young age. And the great scholars of Islam, they say that this happened because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself wanted to take care of the upbringing of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took it upon himself to take care of our Messenger of God sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi, to the extent that the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi said in a hadith, and the hadith scholars have argued about its chain of transmission, but they've all agreed in its meaning, where he sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi says, أدبني ربي فأحسن تأديبي. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught me adab, has taught me etiquettes, has taught me my moral character and how great my moral character is. Sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi. This is our Prophet. To the extent that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes him on a journey of beautiful spiritual and intellectual growth to the heights that no creation has ever gone to. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praises him in the Quran by saying, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. Verily, Muhammad, you are on vast moral character. You can imagine the way that the ayah sounds is as if khuluq, etiquettes, moral character is a throne. And our Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi is the king that sits on that throne. Sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi. These are the gifts that Allah gave him. Allah took care of him. Allah taught him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him food to eat and gave him drink. He said, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi, one time speaking to other people, you're not like me. My Lord gives me nourishment. He gives me food and he gives me to drink directly from him. There's a direct connection. And so that brings us to a beautiful point. How, through what mechanisms did he learn? Through what mechanisms did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teach him and raise him and constantly elevate him to the greatest of ranks? It's through the experience of Allah's names and attributes. Remember, we said before that the Khalifa, the successor, the vicegerent of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth, is the one that represents Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names and attributes at the best humanistic level. So that means we need to experience Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names and attributes to even know what they are. And so the ulama, the great scholars, they say if we look at all of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names and attributes, ultimately they fall into two camps. One being the camp of Jalal, majesty, and another being the camp of Jamal, beauty. Jalali names Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has, and Jamali names. Some of the Jalali names, مثلاً, Al-Qahhar, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Qahhar, Al-Qabid, subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Mudhil, subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can abase. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can withhold. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can overwhelm. Allah can debase. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has within his power subhanahu wa ta'ala to do that which he wills, and we have to patiently go through the trial and tribulation of that experience. But that experience is still an experience of him, because we're experiencing one of his names. And these sometimes are overwhelming names. Sometimes we may find them difficulty. We may find difficulty in them to bear, but bearing them is still experiencing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he has other names, and these are Jamali names. These are names that have some ease to them when we experience them. There's some beauty. For example, Al-Halim, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is forbearant. Sometimes we sin and he doesn't punish us subhanahu wa ta'ala. He doesn't take from us. Al-Razzaq is another name of the names of Al-Jamal, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us sustenance. He gives us subhanahu wa ta'ala wealth. Al-Ghafoor, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives. These are all beautiful things that we want to experience, and they are an experience of the manifestation of the divine. So if we experience Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through his jalal, through his majesty, or we experience him subhanahu wa ta'ala through his jamal, through his beauty, we're still experiencing Allah in both cases. And if I only experience Allah through beauty and I never experience him through his majesty, then my experience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is incomplete. And if I only experience him through his majesty and I don't experience him through his beauty, then my experience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is incomplete. And our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alayhi, we said he had the most complete and exalted station with Allah. Therefore, he experienced Allah in majesty, in jalal, and he experienced Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Jamal. And in both of those experiences, his heart was always with Allah. So long as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was happy with him, the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi didn't mind which one of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's divine names were being manifest in front of him. And so when we look at Al-Qur'an Al-Kareem, when we look at the book of Allah, we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at times addresses the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi through jamal, through beauty. And sometimes he addresses him sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi through jalal, through majesty. For example, an example of jamal, of beauty. Allah says to the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُبَايِعُونَكَ إِنَّمَا يُبَايِعُونَ اللَّهِ. Beautiful. O Muhammad, those that give you the pledge of allegiance, verily, they are pledging allegiance to Allah. That the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi is representing as the Khalifa Allah on earth. So those that give the Prophet bay'ah, a pledge of allegiance, it's as if they gave bay'ah to Allah. Yadullahi fawqa aydihim. The hand of Allah is over their hand, without any anthropomorphic thoughts or ideas. Another ayah. Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna 'alan nabi ya ayyuhalladhina amanu sallu 'alayhi wa sallimu taslima. Allah and his angels send blessings and prayers upon the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi. O you who believe, send blessings and prayers upon the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi. Ya ayyuhan nabi inna arsalnaka shahidan wa mubashshiran wa nadhira وَدَاعِيًا إِلَى اللَّهِ بِإِذْنِهِ وَسِرَاجًا مُنِيرًا. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Prophet of God, we've sent you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts to describe beautiful, beautiful ways in which he describes his character and his being. وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. And verily you are on vast moral character. These are ayat of jamal. And there are ayat in Al-Quran Al-Kareem in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam with his jalal, with his majesty. And I'll give two examples. One of which is an ayah, every time I read it, I get scared. It's so jalali in its outer nature. It's so majestic. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْ تَقَوَّلَ عَلَيْنَا بعض الأقاويل لأخذنا منه باليمين ثم لقطعنا منه الوتين. Subhanallah. Allah is addressing the Prophet, وحاشاه صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وحاشاه. He would never do so, but he says, addressing the Prophet, if Muhammad had made up some verses against us. Meaning if the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi, and he never did and never would have made up some ayat of the Qur'an from himself. لَأَخَذْنَا مِنْهُ بِالْيَمِينِ. We would take him with might. ثُمَّ لَقَطَعْنَا مِنْهُ الْوَتِينِ. SubhanAllah. This is what Allah says in the Qur'an. And then we would have cut off his aorta, artery in the heart that boots and gives blood to the rest of the body. This is a verse of Jalal. It's a verse in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing his majesty. لَيْسَ لَكَ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ شَيْءٍ. In another verse he says, you have nothing to do with this affair. Another verse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's majesty. But these are verses of perfection of the Prophet of God sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi. Because the Prophet of God sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi, he experienced Allah holistically. Therefore, he experienced Jalal and he experienced Jamal. He experienced majesty and he experienced beauty. And through that experience, he had the most perfected knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and became the greatest of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's creation sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi. And I'll close with this. The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi, once talking about himself, he said, I was made to fear in the way of Allah at a time when no one was afraid in the way of Allah, and I felt pain and suffering in the way of Allah, for Allah, at a time when no one else on earth felt pain and suffering in the way of Allah. He experienced hardships, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi. And one of the companions asked him, O Messenger of God, who goes through the most difficulties in life? And the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi replied to him by saying, the prophets and then those that are like them. And of all the prophets, no one went through the challenges that Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi went through. But those challenges from Allah or a way for him to experience Allah's divine, jalali, majestic names, and those times of ease from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or his ability to experience Allah's jamali, beautiful names. They're all an experience of Allah. Therefore, he sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala ali became the abd of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most perfected creation of Allah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shower his blessings upon our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring our hearts, our minds, and our beings in close proximity to him in this world and in the next. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.